Hey, Monarchs, it's Mr. Bryant. We're looking at a lesson today about anger and humiliation, the things that Hitler and many Germans who thought like him felt, and the things that he capitalized on in order to gain power, and also what he used and channeled towards people in marginalized communities, particularly Jewish people, to use them as scapegoats, to blame them for the problems that Germany was facing. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today. So key terms for today are vindictive, which means having or showing a strong or unreasoning for revenge. Meaning, like, you, if you're vindictive towards someone, you are deliberately finding a something to hold against them, even if they don't necessarily warrant that. Things like, you want revenge for, you want revenge, you feel like you've been, something wrong has happened to you. Second is genocide, which is the deliberate and systematic destruction of a racial, political, or cultural group. So for example, the Holocaust is an example of a genocide because they're specifically trying to eliminate and murder as many Jews as possible in Europe. Another example of genocide would be the Rwandan genocide, which we talked about the first semester this year when we watched the movie Hotel Rwanda. All right. The Holocaust was the systematic state-sponsored persecution and murder of approximately 6 million Jews by the Nazi regime and its collaborators. The Shoah is the Hebrew word for Holocaust, so oftentimes Jewish people refer to the Holocaust as Shoah. All right, so in your Google Doc, there are excerpts for anger and humiliation, which is a document that reads or discusses Hitler's beliefs and also actually has quotes or excerpts from his biography, his autobiography called Mein Kampf, which is the German word for my struggle. So this is a book that Hitler wrote, and it was kind of like he wrote it actually from prison when he was imprisoned as a political prisoner for going against the German Republic, the Weimar Republic. And you can kind of read through those excerpts and kind of get a sense of what Hitler was feeling and how he was able to, like, get so many people on his side. Some three key points to kind of take from that as after you've read are that Hitler believed you had to have German blood to be a German citizen. Lots of angry veterans of the World War, the First World War, supported Hitler. He enjoyed the Workers' Party, which eventually became the Nazi Party to create a movement. At 14, his dad died, and then his mom died a few years later. And he believed in the of the Treaty of Versailles, and to abolish something means to get rid of it, to eliminate it. So he didn't think that the Treaty of Versailles was fair to Germany. Remember, Germany was blamed for World War I. All right, so why did Hitler target the Jews? Hitler publicly blamed Jews for Germany's loss of World War I and the economic depression, basically putting it all on their shoulders. And there's no evidence for this, but it's a scapegoat, remember? Someone to take the blame for Germany's problems, such as unemployment and inflation, where money loses its value. And so by blaming Jewish people for that, he could take the responsibility off German shoulders, and then push it onto Jewish people, which gave Germans that wanted to find a sense of national identity and a renewed sense of pride in this idea of German empire. It gave them a something to latch onto and someone to blame for their problems, even though there's no evidence, obviously, that Jewish people were at all responsible for any of these things. But again, it's a scapegoat. It's something Hitler was giving the people something to hate so they could come together in their hatred. All right, so the first stage was the persecution. They started boycotting Jewish businesses in 1933. Remember, boycott means you don't go to those businesses. So Jewish businesses were marked with stars in the windows and often attacked, Star of David, like you can see right here in this window right here. It's a six-pointed star that the Jewish faith uses as a primary symbol. Tens of thousands of Jews were fired from their jobs and banned from universities, so they couldn't go to college or they couldn't work at colleges. This isolated Jewish people socially and economically from German society. So Jewish people were kept away from the rest of Germany and were seen as the other. They were seen as not German, even if they were born in Germany, right? So the use of the SS, which is the Schutzstaffel, which is like the German persecution squadron. They're basically like German special forces that are like high, believe very deeply in Nazism and in anti-Semitism. So they're a very racist organization and the most loyal of Hitler's troops. And responsible for some of the worst atrocities in during the Holocaust and World War II. SS troops, this is in this image, are placing the Jewish Star of David on a Jewish business. You can see them walking around. These are more SS troops demonstrating outside a Jewish business, basically telling them that to basically telling people not to shop there because they're Jewish. Stage two was classification, where you would categorize things, in this case, people. The Nuremberg Laws in 1935, we've talked about them before, were a series of anti-Semitic laws determined German citizenship, classified society in Germans of mixed blood or Jews. So basically saying like, sorry, I misspoke a little bit. Classified society in Germany, that's a typo, my bad, basically as such. So if you were mixed blood, so you weren't purely German, pure blood Germany or German, or you're Jewish, they would ban marriages and sexual acts between Jews and non-Jews. So if you were Jewish and wanted to marry someone that was Christian, you could not do that. Those classified as Jewish had to wear a yellow Star of David. So like a patch that would go on your shirt or an armband that you would have to wear that would show it. And I want you to think about this is, why is classifying who is Jewish important to causing discrimination? If you classify certain people, you force them to wear a Star of David in public on their arm or on their shirt, what does that do to the people that see you? It means that they know, hey, that's one of them. That's a Jewish person. I don't trust them. I hate them because of all they've done against Germany, right? Again, obviously not true, but it's a way for the Nazis to exert power over people that they wanted to oppress. You see example of a Jewish patch right here. It says Juda, which is the German word for Jewish. And that would be sewn onto people's clothing. They had to wear it by law. Okay, so other stages, there's badges of hate, and you're gonna see a chart in a little bit, and there's also a chart in your Google Doc showing them. Other groups that Hitler opposed were forced to wear these badges to signify their position in society. This is an antisocial badge, meaning that they're antisocial people. Other groups that Hitler opposed were, this is the same thing reading again, so again, homosexuals, so people that would be today classified as LGBTQI plus would have to wear an upside down pink triangle. If you were Jewish and homosexual, they would take a yellow part of a yellow Star of David and then add a pink triangle over it to show that you were both Jewish and gay. A green upside down triangle showed that you were a criminal. So they would classify people in different ways like this to kind of like let people know who they were. The third stage was discrimination. The Jewish community was denied their civil rights, so like things to right to own a business, property, the right to vote. And eventually in 1938, in November, we talked about this before, is Kristallnacht, the Night of the Broken Night of Broken Glass. And the significance of this is the Nazis used the incident as an excuse to go beyond legal repression or control to large-scale physical violence against Jewish Germans, basically saying like, we're not going to control them with laws anymore. We're actually going to attack them or kill them now. Kristallnacht results in thousands of Jewish shops and synagogues being destroyed. A synagogue, again, is a Jewish temple or basically their equivalent of a church. 30,000 Jews are arrested and sent to concentration camps. And this is kind of the beginning of concentration camps being used as labor camps and eventually being changed into just extermination camps where Jewish people are killed. Okay, so this is an image from Kristallnacht right here. You can see a Jewish synagogue burning, the Star of David on the front of the synagogue. All right, so here's the chart you're going to use in your Google Doc. And again, you're just looking at them, and I want you to take in all the different ways people were classified. If they were a political prisoner, they would be put with a red upside down triangle. If they were an emigrant, meaning they're someone that was had emigrated to the country, they would be an upside down blue triangle. Keeping track of people that are immigrants, do you, right? Again, they want pure blood Germans, right? And then all of this could be classified as doubly as if they were Jewish. And then a pure yellow star would just be someone that was just Jewish, not any of these other subcategories. You have these other symbols at the bottom. Wait for that Google thing to show disappear. There we go. All right, so political prisoners in France are the red upside-down triangles. You have the political second-time offenders, a red triangle with the bar over it. That shows that they did something twice against the government. Political meaning like they're anti-fascist, they're anti-Nazi. A penal company is like a prison company. So that's what the circle underneath the red triangle means. And then a right side up triangle is a Wehrmacht prisoner. Wehrmacht is the German army. So basically these are German army prisoners. And finally, prisoners under special surveillance have a little target on them, meaning people have to watch them. Okay. This is an explanation of what those things are, just in case you can't read the graphic. This is in the individual presentation too. Okay. All right, guys. Have a great weekend. Make sure that you caught up on any work that you're missing. You can retake the test if you haven't, if you need to. You just need to come to the office hours or shoot me an email and we'll work it out. Make sure to come to the Google Meets if you need any help. I hope you guys are having a great time in distance learning. I know it's difficult and a challenge. I miss seeing you guys all in class. Have a great day, guys.